like the drink was a regular. This would be pulling an extra weight, amen.
Yeah.
I also want to say thank you to the musician and to the singers,
right,
the choir. These services wouldn't have been the same without you.
Right.
And I don't want to be an ingrate and come and act as if all of it centers around me. And all it centers around a message. There's no two ways about that. Mm-hmm. But I do thank you for being a part of the service. And trust me, I went to Columbia, South America. And we started a church. And we had nobody to sing. Then when we got some folk to sing, they couldn't sing. I mean, I'm being honest with you, they couldn't carry a tune in the bucket. They're the awfulest squawking I've ever heard in my life. And of course, I mean, they thought I could sing. Now, you mean, that is a lie, but I mean, they thought I needed to teach them how to sing. I tried to say, no, you need to talk to my wife, and she'll try to instruct you on how to sing. But I just want you to know that you need it. You understand that your place is important in the church.
Right.
Amen.
Every one of us. I'd like to just take a Bible tonight and preach on the members of the body. It's not what God has ordained. But we're going to look at this again tonight. And I'm going to review just a little bit. I promise you, I'll have you out of here at least by the same time. I got the clock. Somebody put a clock up here after the first night. I think it might have been up there. I just didn't notice it. When I preach, I don't stay up here much, so y'all know that. That might have been what happened. But then they might have been somebody come up here. Is this a little bigger? Y'all put that one up here. I'm just kidding. John chapter 4. Tonight, we'll get into the word of the Lord and see what he has for us. I'd like to start tonight, and we just have to go back to verse 1. I'm not going to read for the sake of time. Because we covered a lot of this last night, I just wanted to pick up. I felt like God wanted us to pick up where we left off last night. And we were looking at the greatest missionary that's ever been. Can I just say tonight that you'll never improve on the example Jesus gave you.
Right.
Amen.
Yeah. Paul's a great missionary, but he's not better than the one we're talking about tonight.
Right.
Amen.
And nobody has left his home so glorious. Came so far into a country that was so opposite of him and loved his creation and gave it the gospel outside of Jesus Christ. And I promise you, he is the best example for all things. Let's read just a few verses here, then we'll get back into the message. When therefore the Lord knew how that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again into Galilee. And he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being weary with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. Then there cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, how is it that thou, being a Jew, wait a minute, let me find the place again. I was sitting there quoting the love. What verse was I in? Man, I lost it just as quick as that. I said, what? 9. I was over here 25. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which I am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman saith unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. And whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, or which gave us the well to drink thereof, himself and his children and the kine and his cattle? Jesus said, answered and said unto her, Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Let's pray, and then we'll get back into the message. Father, Lord, tonight again I confess to you, confess to these before me, Lord, that I cannot preach. God, preaching is not just getting up and, Lord, spitting out a bunch of words. Preaching is a spiritual work. God, it takes you to communicate, God, this word unto our hearts tonight. Lord, we long, we pray today, we called on you and pleaded with you that you'd help us to be in your will tonight, God, that you would take control of this vessel, God, for your glory and your honor tonight. We just ask you, Lord, to take the message and Father, to cause it to sink deep in our heart, Lord, tonight. Oh, take thy word, God, which is spirit and which is life. And Lord, put thy spade in the good ground of your saints tonight. And Lord, plow, God, up that good ground, Father, again. Lord, we'll thank you, Father, for it. And Lord, if there be one lost here tonight that does not know you, I pray, God, you might work in their soul. I pray, Lord, you might draw them to the one and only God, the one and only name whereby men must be saved, that precious and lofty, that hallowed name, Jesus. Oh, how we thank you today for your goodness. Help us now. Lord, we'll give you the glory and the honor because unto you it belongs. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Now, tonight, as we said, I'm just going to recap a little bit about last night. And we were looking at the will of God, as you remember. And we were looking about what God did for Jesus and how his will has to be the start of missions. It has to be the start of winning souls. It has to be the start of a man's call to a mission field. It has to be the start of this church's desire to spread the gospel, not only here in your Jerusalem, but in Judea, and then in the uttermost parts of the world. You have to be, and we have to be, all in God's will as we strive to do that. We looked at last night that there was a vision in God's will before Jesus went. We see that that vision was through Samaria. And we talked about going to how God's will is through somewhere. And how we get so focused on a designated place. And I just wish as Christians we could understand God's not worried about a geographical place on this earth, that he's not sending us to a designated place so much as he's sending us to dying souls. And our lives can always find dying souls all around us. And that is God's will. We just we get focused on places and things, and we bypass all that God wants us to really touch. And I'm not going to re-preach that, but we saw that last night, that through somewhere was sufficient for providential guidance. And we looked at the things around that. And tonight I want to look at for just a few minutes that through somewhere is sufficient direction for practical grace. Now, for practical grace, when you have a sovereign Savior setting up a situation to speak, you see, we need practical grace to give forth the gospel. And a missionary, he's going to need God's grace upon him. Not just providential guidance, but a practical grace. And there'll be practical grace when we're in God's guidance, when we're in His will. He will do a work. God does set up a place for Him to speak. Can I just say that again? God does prepare a place for His word to go forth. He prepares a situation. He prepares a condition. Ain't that right? Ain't that rightly so? I mean, we're not talking about another man. We're not talking about men that men esteem. We're not talking about your forefathers and people that we regard, that we make statues after. We're not talking about the President of the United States, whether they be good or bad. We're talking about the Creator of all things. I'm telling you, He deserves to be able to prepare a situation and a condition and an atmosphere for Him to speak.
Amen.
His word is precious. His word is wonderful. His word is powerful, brother.
Amen.
You know, the word inspiration means God breathed.
Yeah.
And don't run by the breath of God. I mean, the breath of God was there in the beginning. God breathed into the nostrils of Adam, and every little baby ever since then has that first breath.
Amen.
Has drawn that breath, and it keeps on going.
Amen.
You understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
There's not been a one that can stop it yet, brothers.
Amen.
I'm telling you, it just keeps on happening over and over. God just did it once.
Amen.
It left His mouth one time. It's just been pushing forward and pushing forward through generation after generation after generation.
Amen.
I'm talking about something awful powerful. We're talking about God's word. We're talking about His breath. And I'm telling you, when it goes forth, God has prepared a place for it.
Amen.
He has prepared a heart and a conditioned heart for it. Now, I want to look at just a couple of things here as we begin to look at this thing. I want to say that God here has prepared this time in His providential guidance to speak to this lady. God is opening a door to this woman. He's crossing boundaries here, you see. He's a Jew. She's a Samaritan. They don't most have any dealings.
Right.
Can I just say tonight, you can't box in God.
Amen.
Me and Ben, the pastor, were talking today, and I was telling him, I was confessing to him, God's been for a long time trying to get me to understand that the Christian life is not cubbyholes of certain duties and obligations all around me that I have, such as missions and prayer and reading and studying the Bible and telling men kind to others and loving the saints and this and that and the other. It's not little cubby holes that I'm supposed to go to each cubby hole and dab in and do just a little bit here and a little bit here so I can feel good about myself.
Amen.
They're all connected because it's alive, you see.
Amen.
Could I just try to illustrate with the fact that you have life in your eyes, do you not?
Yes. Amen.
Somehow there's life in your eyes.
Amen.
That connects to your brain, which is living. But they're two different parts.
Amen.
Which connects to your heart, which is living. You have ears. Most of us are ears, and I'm not trying to be funny, but most of our ears are not dead. We're not deaf. They're living. They're vibrating. They're a part of our life.
Amen.
We're able to touch.
Amen.
We're able to taste like that good chicken tonight. It's that life that connects all of that and blends it. And makes it what it is.
Amen.
See, too many of us trying to cubbyhole God in our life. We're trying to do a little bit here, a little bit there. We're trying to do enough to soothe the conscience.
Right.
Instead of being what God wants us to be.
Right.
Amen.
You know what I'm talking about? I'm talking about being a Christian. All the way in.
Amen.
Both feet.
Yes.
In being a missionary. I'm not just trying to lay responsibility on you. I'm trying to get you to understand, folk. Not everybody has been breathed upon by the life-giving gospel.
Amen.
Not everybody has been given that with the Holy Ghost anointed presentation.
Amen.
And us that are saved are the only ones that have that ability to give forth that gospel in that manner.
Amen.
You've got a lot of people preaching a gospel. Most of brothers preaching another gospel.
Yes. Right.
It's another gospel outside of that Bible.
Amen.
I'm still convinced God's saving people, even here in the United States.
Oh, yeah.
I just seen it about 2 weeks ago. You see what I'm trying to say? I believe God is still saving people, not just all around the world, but He'll save them here too. There's some people around this place. They're broken and they feel deserted and alone, and they've all up in the corner in their life and they don't know how to get out, and they need somebody to take the life to them.
Amen.
Take the gospel to them. And I'm trying to tell you tonight, you and I have it. I love, absolutely love, hearing a man set on fire for what people God sent me to.
Amen.
It bothers me when I see missionaries and all I can see on their display is buildings and places. I don't see faces.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
When I went to Columbia the first time, brother, I come back and I was talking faces in my heart.
Right.
I was talking to little old faces of babies that were orderly. They'd been beat up and nobody was doing nothing about it. Sin had beat them up. I was talking faces of little 10, 11-year-old girls that were being sold for prostitution because nobody had the gospel there, brother. Because Satan was having his way. Little old 10, 11-year-old boys tracks up and down the arm, sitting around in groups smoking dope because there was no hope in their life.
Right.
Nobody ever told them. Catholic Church, all they do is tell them to just get out of the way. We don't want you anyway. You're the scourge, you're the trash of the earth. We just want the good Catholics that have money.
Right. That's it.
They didn't have nothing to help them with anyway.
Right.
Every little old soul I see out on those streets sleeping out there, I try to give them a track, try to talk to them.
Yeah.
I remember talking to a man one day out there in Columbia, and he was sitting around a bunch of him and his fellas, and they was drinking some old homemade white wine, and I guess the best way I can describe it, that they made down there because they couldn't afford nothing else, had that chain of alcohol on them, they couldn't get away from it. I was trying to tell them, I said, why don't you come to church Sunday? I said, let me tell you the gospel. They're sitting there passing that bottle around. They said, tell us, preacher, we're not going nowhere. I sat down right in the middle of them, began to preach the gospel to them right there.
Amen.
You know what they told me? I ain't saying they all accepted it right there, but listen to what they told me. They said, preacher, if what you just told me was the truth, and all I told them was the gospel,
right,
and how Jesus loved them. They said, if what you just told us is the truth, that is the most beautiful. I'm talking about grown men.
Right.
They said, that's the most beautiful thing I think I've ever heard.
Hey.
A bunch of drunks sitting around, said that brother. You know why? Because they were that miserable. I'm afraid sometimes, I'm going to say this, I'm going to move on, but I'm afraid sometimes we don't go to the miserable.
Right.
Amen.
We won't leave them where they're at. All because they don't know how to act in church. Mm-hmm. We speaking up some folk on the bus back home, and not too long ago, and they just come out Jehovah's Witnesses. I tell a preacher about it today. We knocked on their door. They had just left Jehovah's Witnesses, had just moved into our neighborhood. We knocked on that door the day they moved in, or the day after they moved in. That providential guidance about God's will.
Right.
And they said, "You sure?" Said, "We want to come to church." Really? And, I mean, didn't give no resistance. Said, "We'll be there Sunday morning. Do we need to walk, or will you pick us up?" Come in there, the guy, his name's John. He black fellow, big old tall guy, about 6'5", 6'6". Little wife with him there. Come in that Sunday morning, he's lost, got earrings hanging all out of his ears and everything. He don't know nothing about God. He don't have any. Come in there in the church, my preacher started preaching up the glory of the Lord. Begin to deal with things, begin to get down, talk about practical things and how life will beat you up. And he was lost as he could be. But he was sitting there with both hands raised like that, just bawling like a baby. You know why, brother? Because he was hurt so bad that nobody had an answer for his hurt.
Amen. That's true.
Until he got in that church that day.
Amen.
Still he got saved, brother. But he ain't missed a Sunday of the month. Ain't missed a Sunday night in a month.
Yeah.
Hadn't missed, now hold your seat, put on your seatbelt. Hadn't missed a Wednesday night in a month. And they lost.
Right.
Yeah. So what are you saying? I'm saying they're all around us and they're hurting.
Yeah.
And there's one thing that can blow into their life.
Yeah.
It's that breath.
Yeah. Amen.
You realize that breath blew the gospel the first time. Jesus was the one that breathed the gospel out that first time. And it's been jumping from one witness to another, saving folk all through the generations.
Amen.
That breath's so awful powerful. You realize the worst thing could happen with this church right is that the gospel would stop with your generation.
Right.
That this little one here, that these little ones here, that it don't breathe through the generations of this church.
Yeah.
Amen. You know what our problem is today? Missionaries are coming off the field. I mean, it's hard to take over there a lot of times physically.
Yeah.
You get in troubles, you just can't do. You've got to come here if you want to stay alive.
Right.
Amen.
You got to deal with it sometimes. Or you die over there, some choose to die. I'm not trying to say what God's will is either way. I'm simply saying this. They're coming back. And the generation of kids today know not God.
Yeah. Right.
Right, man.
But before we amen that now, and I'm a part of this, it's us who's at fault.
Mm-hmm.
You know why? Because we ain't been out there knocking that door.
Mm-hmm.
We ain't been out there taking them kids with us.
Yeah.
We ain't been out there getting that church service together, praying, begging God, not just the preacher. You know how revival used to happen? Charles Spurgeon had 100 men
right.
every service
right.
directly under his pulpit crying out to God that they'd come visit them. And on the way to them, they just hit him.
Yeah.
Right.
This thing ain't about programs.
Amen.
It's about life.
Amen.
And it's about a life that needs to be working here on the pew.
Amen.
Before it goes forward.
Yep.
I'm all for missions. But I ain't willing to lose my own mission. I'm trying to preach tonight because we need God to move amongst us.
Amen.
God's opening the door to speak to this woman. Do you realize what the Bible said there? Now I'm trying to just do what God told me. I'm skipping points I got, but I'm trying to do exactly what God told me to do tonight.
Amen.
That woman, when he told her something I can't find that Jesus told anybody else in the Bible. Now, see, this is a woman who'd been married 5 times, and she's living in outright adultery and fornication now with the man. And she tells Jesus there, she says, "Evermore, give me that living water." And the first thing he does, folks, is what? He goes straight to her sin. Go call my husband. That's the part we don't want. You say, "Well, I thought it was awful weird he's denied him go to Revelation and start preaching on unforgiveness." This is a missions meeting. It wasn't supposed to be about unforgiveness. Looks like to me it's what Jesus did.
Amen.
He went straight to the heart of the matter. Amen. He got right down there where they lived, where she lived. Got right there where she lived. Started dealing with that sin, did God? Got that thing straight. Why? Because he's got plans for this lady.
Amen.
Could you imagine tonight? I mean, if it crossed your mind that God has planned for this group of believers here tonight.
Amen.
He got a plan for this church. He knows what he's doing. She goes and she says something to him that I find so amazing here. She says to him when he asked her for a drink of water, she said, he tells her, he said, "If you knew who I was, you'd be asking me for a drink." She said, "What you gonna draw me in?" She said, "You ain't got no pot." See, the pot she had, we got it in our heads a lot of times because we remember movies and stuff like that. We always think of a whale, it's got a little rope on it. You drop a bucket, it's always tied to it, you know, and you bring that up and you pour it in your pot. But the fact that she tells Jesus here that he don't have anything to draw with lets me know that there's nothing hanging over that way. Mm-hmm. That she has a special kind of pot that either, and there is a rope, and she tells him, she said, "The well's deep and you don't have anything to draw with." So to draw it up is what she's got in her hand. She's got that pot, you see. The point is, she didn't realize that she wasn't talking to somebody who needed a pot.
Right.
She was talking to a new whale.
Right.
She was talking to a different whale altogether. A divine whale. And God, Jesus, tells this lady something here that he didn't tell anybody else. She said, "We know that Christ will come, and when he comes, he'll come." Now you correct me if I'm wrong.